Research published last year in the journal Scientific Reports shows the massive Himalayan glaciers have shrunk 10 times faster over the past four decades than during the previous seven centuries. This threatens agriculture and the water supply for millions of people across South Asia. Fred DeSam Lazaro reports on one project that's aimed at blunting the environmental impact, at least for some communities high in the Himalayas. It's part of Fred's series, Agents for Change, and it's produced in partnership with the Pulitzer Center.
It's spring planting time in India's Ladakh region, tough, rocky terrain plowed by farmers and the beasts they coax forward in song, a cross species between oxen and yaks. This group of families tilling the land are among a dwindling rural population along this 300-mile stretch of the Tibetan plateau, some 13,000 feet above sea level. All around them are terraced fields that were once cultivated, their neighbors having migrated in recent years to cities in search of work, driven increasingly by unpredictable weather. Water is an ever-present worry, says 42-year-old Jigmet Chozeng.
The water comes from that glacier. It has to be divided among many people. It was not reaching us down here.
This mountainous region is one of the driest places on Earth. Historically, rainfall has averaged just 3 inches per year. People here have depended on water trickling down from mountain glaciers, but in recent decades, those glaciers have been shrinking and weather patterns have become erratic. Many scientists predict that those glaciers could disappear altogether by the end of this century.
We are the first victims at the frontier.
Sonam Wangchuk, a local educator and environmentalist, came up with one solution called ice stupas that provide water in early spring.
Some would call it artificial baby glaciers.
In May, he took me up to see one of these structures, named for their resemblance to the Buddhist monuments that dot the landscape. It's not so much about a shortage of water, he says, it's about controlling when it flows.
There's not enough when you need it. There's too much when you don't. So it's an issue of optimization.
Solid ice.
About 9 years ago, Wangchuk and his students came up with the idea to store water by freezing it during the cold months. Their first challenge, to keep it frozen and slow the pace at which it would normally melt. A problem solved with the conical stupa shape, built on a foundation of brush and branches to help freeze the water more quickly.
These shapes have low surface area, means the sun doesn't get enough surface area to melt it. We're sort of cheating the sun.
So suppose there's a mountain range like we are in.
Wangchuk is an engineer by training, but says this is not rocket science. No pumps, no electric power, just basic physics and geometry.
So upstream somewhere here, you put a pipe and then bring it downstream to where you need. When water enters this pipe, it goes down and wants to go up and up and up to this level. Then it splashes the water in the air, and that way it falls down and freezes.
He says the stupas can reach heights of up to 160 feet and store several million gallons of water. Starting in April and May, it begins to melt, swelling the streams, irrigating farms, and helping green the dry landscape.
After the ice stupa was placed here 3 years ago, everyone gets equal water. It's good for the crops.
Are you living happily ever after in this area in terms of the glaciers disappearing?
Not at all. We consider these very humble, insignificant tweakings compared to what we are going to face.
They are a short-term solution, he says, and the lack of reliable water supply isn't the only problem caused by climate change. Glacial water is being replaced by rain, falling over land that cannot absorb it fast enough, with disastrous consequences.
2006, there was a big flash flood, and I asked a casual elderly man, when did you see last time such a devastating flash flood? He said, I don't remember, not in my lifetime. And you know what? The next one was in 2010, and with much more fierce devastation. The next after that was 2012, 2015, 2017.
The 2010 cloudburst alone brought 14 inches in 2 hours, killing more than 200 people and causing widespread damage.
We need to think of even the eras after glaciers. And to prepare for that, we need to sow the seeds today, and which is what we have gathered here today for.
Wangchuk has helped spearhead an effort to plant indigenous trees to help contain flooding. The implications of climate change patterns spread far beyond these mountains, which are the source of the Indus, Ganges, and Brahmaputra river systems that support the livelihood of some 129 million farmers across a region of nearly a billion people. The future will be marked by uncertainty, says water expert Himanshu Thakkar.
There are times when there is suddenly heavy rainfall or snowfall, and then there are other times when there is a much drier periods. Longer, drier periods. We don't know whether the higher rainfall will compensate the glacial melted, to what extent it will do. So it will depend. So these are a bit question mark. To what extent the water flow will reduce.
The anxiety over water flow has even fueled some resistance to the ice stupas. Sering Motup, leader in the village of Thay, got authorities to stop one greening project that would have been fed by a stupa, complaining that the water diversion would come at the expense of his community, which is further down the mountain.
These trees would grow big, taking the water in June and July, and our farms would be dry. It would have been very difficult for the villages below.
So whenever there is a diversion, there is resistance. But the only problem is that in this case, the diversion happens in winter when nobody uses water. But it will take some time for people to get used to the idea that it is only to keep it reserved for summer so they can get more.
And it's not just people here who must embrace new ideas, he adds.
The bigger solution is in the hands of people perhaps watching this show, whose lifestyle in big cities like New York or New Delhi is causing climate change. Our call should become an SOS call for the bigger world out there. It's because of their activities that we suffer for no fault of ours.
He invokes a plea once used by Mahatma Gandhi. Live simply, Wangchuk says, so we may simply live. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Fred DeSam Lazaro in Ladakh, India.
And you heard it, an SOS call to all of us right here. Fred's reporting is a partnership with the Undertold Stories Project at the University of St. Thomas in Minnesota.